We're down here at Nudgee Beach at the Tabalbandargan Mangrove Walk, which means place of salt water.
And today we're going to look at six different mangrove species, and we're going to look at their adaptations to dealing with this environment.
When we talk about adaptations, we're talking about unique features which enable a plant or an animal to survive in a particular environment or habitat.
Yeah, so these particular mangroves have to do with a high amount of salinity. Okay, so we're going to look at a few different ways that they deal with that.
Absolutely, it's a very challenging environment, but our mangrove species are up to the challenge. Let's have a look at species number one.
Let's do it. Our first mangrove we're going to look at today is the Milky mangrove.
Also known as the blind your eye mangrove. Whoa. Because you don't want to get this sap in your eye.
Where would we find this mangrove?
It's found more at the high tide mark, so it doesn't get full inundation with salt water like some of our other mangrove species, but it still has to cope with a certain amount of salt water. How does it do this? It is a salt concentrator, so it concentrates the salt in its older leaves, and then those leaves drop off, and that's its way of getting rid of excess salt in the plant.
Sort of like a sacrificial leaf.
That's right, yeah.
Introducing the yellow mangrove. So obviously the telltale sign that it's a yellow mangrove is that yellowish greeny color. The telltale sign is the leaves always point upwards in this mangrove species. They have a buttress root, which means their roots tend to sit above the surface of the mud, and that helps them to stabilize. The cool thing with these guys, they have what we call propagules, and that's their seed pods, these long bits sticking down. And what they'll do, they'll break off, land in the water, and they always float vertically. Okay, once they float, find some mud, they'll actually grow a new plant from there.
Over here we have the river mangrove, which has a very specialized adaptation of dealing with this saltwater environment. If you have a really close look at the leaves, you'll notice some fine salt crystals all over the leaves. That's part of the adaptation for the plant. It extrudes salt from its leaves, so therefore getting rid of salt from the plant. It also concentrates salt in the old leaves as well. The river mangrove gets some pretty white flowers that have a smell of ripe bananas, and animals such as bats are good pollinators for the river mangrove. Down here we have a beautiful example of the iconic mangrove species, the red mangrove. They have these really iconic prop roots, which are really obvious and distinguish them from some of the other mangrove species.
And they get the name red mangrove from the red colour on the roots. And the other cool adaptation that they have is these thick waxy leaves, and that helps them to retain some of the moisture.
Their strategy for dealing with the saltwater environment is that they're blocking salt uptake from their roots and also concentrating salt into the older leaves and getting rid of it that way.
They also have their seed pods, which are called propagules, and they're really long on this species, kind of cigar shape, and they actually float vertical, much like the yellow mangrove.
This is probably my favourite mangrove. Really? This is the large-leafed orange mangrove. They're really beautiful, aren't they? They've got these big, large, green, glossy leaves, and they're quite waxy. That helps to retain water. And their strategies or their adaptations for dealing with salt are to exclude salt at the roots and also, again, concentrate it in the old leaves and get rid of it that way.
One thing I really love about the orange mangrove is the way that their seed pods, or remember that word, propagule, grow. They kind of look like a little octopus. And what will happen, the propagule will grow from the middle and then drop off. And much like the red mangrove and the yellow mangrove, it will float around until it finds a suitable spot in the mud or the sand to grow a whole new mangrove. It's really cool. Hey, check this out.
Yeah, that's an impressive hollow.
It is an impressive hollow. So this is on the grey mangrove. Once they get to this larger size, they can develop hollows. And really, really, really important habitat.
Absolutely. There's all kinds of species in the mangroves here that will utilise a piece of real estate like a tree hollow like this. You might find snakes living in there. You might find different birds, possums, animals like that. They all love hollows as shelter in the habitat.
So the most dominant species of mangrove in the Bunda wetlands is the grey mangrove, which is what you see all around us. Now, this is a pioneer species, and what that means, it's the first species of mangrove to grow in this area. Now, these guys are pretty big, and they can grow to a very, very ripe old age indeed.
The thing that you will notice about the grey mangrove is all these little peg or pencil-like things sticking up from the mud, and that's part of its root system. They're called nematophores. They help the grey mangrove to breathe, essentially, to absorb oxygen and exchange gas, even though they're down in the mud. So it gets those roots up out of the mud to enable gas exchange.
So as you can see, mangroves are really, really important for the wildlife.
Absolutely, habitat. But as well as that, they're a carbon sink, they protect against erosion, and they're really important for filtering all kinds of pollutants. So how can we work together to protect mangroves?
We can act to keep our dog on a leash.
Absolutely.
We got a saying at the Environment Centres, and that's take three for the sea. And what that means is if you can take three pieces of rubbish every day, you're going to do your part for helping a wetland like this. Well, that's it from us, guys. Make sure you come out and experience the Boondall Wetlands. In particular, walk the Tablebindargan track here at Nudgee Beach.
Hope to see you soon. See you later.